Welcome, everyone. On a little show of hands, how many of you know Nextcloud pretty well or even use it? About half? All right, that's not very helpful. I wanted to know how much I should talk about what it does and why and all that, but, well, I can't skip it, that's for sure, so I'll go over that. So I have a pretty, well, quite a lot of slides, about 70. Not 200, because, you know, that really doesn't fit. I have to see how far we'll get. All right. Welcome, everyone. My name is Jos Portvliet. I wasn't born there, but my father was. It's a little farm on an island in the Netherlands. Very rural area. My wife always calls me a farmer's boy, and that's, well, I guess kind of true. But I studied psychology and did open source as a hobby while I was working in business consulting. Luckily, I recovered from that and got a job at SUSE. After that, I did OwnCloud and now Nextcloud. So that's why I'm here, obviously. I do live in Berlin, but I'm still very much Dutch. Yeah, I think that's enough about me. So I want to talk a little bit about the good and the bad of the cloud. And okay, don't get close there. The value of privacy and what you can do to protect it with Nextcloud, of course. And I'll go a little bit over this 200 things you can do with Nextcloud. So my goal of that, the 200 things come from the number of apps that we have, which is roughly that. Obviously, not all of those are super awesome. Some of them are very small, etc. But I'll try to cover at least a lot of them and a lot of things you can do. And I also have a few things that I think even more experienced Nextcloud users will not know you can do with Nextcloud, which I think is nice. I hope so. However, I won't get the 200 because that's just a bit crazy. Please interrupt me anytime if you have questions. Hold the microphone closer. There you go. Sorry and thank you. All right. So the good and bad of the cloud. Now, I think a lot of you here are techies or almost everyone, so I don't need to tell you that the cloud has a lot of really nice features. I really like that when I went on holiday, I mean, yeah, maybe it's creepy, but when I went to the US not that long ago, a week ago, Google told me, hey, do you want me to download the maps of the area where you're going to? So it had clearly read my emails, figured out that I was flying to Los Angeles, and it told me, hey, I can download the map because you might not have data there, which indeed I didn't. It's a bit creepy, but it's actually very useful information to have. And I also like the fact that, you know, on Google Maps, you can see how busy it is in a restaurant, generally speaking, at a certain time. But of course, the reason Google knows that is because it is tracking almost every visitor in that restaurant and therefore knows how many people there are at that time. And there are downsides to that, as we probably, many of us at least, are aware. But it's really cool. I mean, your data is accessible everywhere. You have online backups, right? If you lose your phone, you buy a new one, you enter a password, and you're basically back where you started. Your apps get automatically reinstalled, your contacts, your calendar, everything is back. That's really awesome and really useful. You can share with other people, edit documents online, have video calls, and all of this is free. Well, you know, kind of, which gets us to the next point. I mean, this is, of course, not free. And we pay to some degree with our data. Some of the data, is like location data, is, among other things, used by Google to, you know, tell you when it's going to be busy in a restaurant and to tell you how long it's going to take to do your daily commute. But the Tinder app, or the company Tinder, they buy location data from Google. And I have no idea why, to be honest. I know that you give them permission if you install the app. You have to give permission. So when you use the app, it needs to know your location. That's completely logical, right? I mean, otherwise it can't tell you who's near you. But you, why do they then also use the fact that they got that permission to then ask Google for your location data all the frigging time? What do they use that for? I have no idea. Maybe they want to predict where you're going and already prepare a date for you, but otherwise. So you know, you don't know what's really happening with all this data. Yeah, where is it? Who has access to it? And how is it used? And generally speaking, the answers to these questions are, if you care about privacy, are worried about democracy and these things, and the answers to these questions are not great. There are problems. And it's in the cloud, but that doesn't really answer your question. The question, the real question you need to get the answer to is, who has access? What are they doing with my data? Now, of course, these guys have access to your data. Yeah, and they use that access. I mean, Dropbox has been deleting copyrighted content. If you had put a file on your Dropbox and it was copyrighted, they would detect that and delete it. Fair enough, you know, you shouldn't be breaking the law maybe with copyrighted content. So last year, Google started deleting porn, all of it. Even the porn made by porn stars, which they were exchanging via Google Drive with their customers. Now, you might not like the porn business, but come on, this is just interfering in people's, well, business and private data, right? They shouldn't be automatically looking at all these images. Yeah, I know there are no humans looking at it, but still, they were just going through the data and deleting stuff. That's just not right. Yeah, and May 1st this year, Microsoft, technically, the Microsoft license for Skype and Office and everything doesn't allow offensive language and inappropriate content, whatever the heck that is. So basically, if during a Skype call you say fuck, you are in breach of the license agreement of Skype, I guess. So in theory, they could monitor these conversations. They do all run through the servers after all, and what, ban you for a week every time you say something nasty? I mean, you did agree with these licenses when you installed the software and started using it. Well, maybe not at the time, but of course, their license agreement that you signed back in the day you installed it also included the right for them to change it whenever the heck they wanted and not notify you. So, yeah, you did agree. So, there is a thing called privacy, right, that plays in all of this. And I have to deal with a kind of an elephant in the room, because everybody, when you talk about privacy, and especially people like my dad, they say, I have nothing to hide, I don't care. And to some degree, I use Gmail, okay? That's why Google tells me, hey, do you want me to download the map? So I'm also not keeping my data very much to myself. So I kind of get my dad. It's okay to not personally have a big problem with it. But it's a problem for us as a society, yeah? And there's a bunch of reasons for that, and I will go quickly over these because I think a lot of you are familiar with it, but I think it's also important to rehash them occasionally. And the first is, you should have something to hide, or you do have something to hide, even if you don't know. The thing is, in the US at least, there are like 30, 40,000 rules and regulations. And in Europe, it's not much different. The number of laws is just amazingly big, and there are so many ways to break them. You don't usually even know it. Yeah, I have most of my examples from the US. I know, wrong audience, but I'm sure some of you can give me some examples from around here. But in the US, in most states, it's illegal to have a live lobster with you. I'm sure most people aren't aware of that, although I guess most people don't carry those around very often. In Washington, it's illegal to be smelly. The thing is, these laws are not being used that often. They're kind of used as at the discretion of the police. Yeah, of course, why is there a law against being smelly? It's not for a bunch of partygoers who use too much eau de cologne. But it is being used for getting rid of homeless people who are bothering people who are shopping, for example. Then you just, as police, you always have some rules kind of in your pocketbook that will always apply somewhere, sometime, at some point. And this isn't necessarily bad, because arguing that homeless people are bothering people and having a special law against that, that's complicated, it might make total sense to try to move them to a better spot. It's not necessarily bad that the police has these rules in their pocketbook. The problem is, if you start to surveil everyone all the time, you suddenly know them breaching these little rules all the time. And at any point in time, if you would have a full record of what they've been doing in the last weeks or months, at any point you want to punish them for something, let's say being an annoying activist for a local group that is bothering you politically, you can just look at that list and find a couple of offenses that they did and use that to make them back off. And that's a problem. Yeah? These rules aren't necessarily the problem. It's just a problem if you combine them with our, well, surveillance state that we're inadvertently building here together. So this is just stuff that's happening that yeah, you don't have anything to hide, but you kind of do. You just don't really know about it. Yeah, and of course, there's lots of stuff you want to hide. I mean, government isn't perfect. They shouldn't always know everything about us happening. I mean, we wouldn't have gotten, you know, rid of slavery if the laws would have been executed always perfectly, right? It's the same with things like gay marriage. I mean, these things were legal, by the way. So an argument you often hear is, look, if you do something illegal, you should be punished. Well, I disagree. Yeah, what's morally right isn't always legal, and what's legal isn't always morally right. You need to keep that in mind. So the last point I want to make when you're talking about I have nothing to hide is, again, I'm a psychologist. How many of you have visited a psychologist or a psychiatrist? I have. I know most people don't like to talk about that. Why is that? Well, if you go get a new job, you don't necessarily want your boss to know you're just recovering from a burnout. Yeah? Or that you occasionally suffer from depression. If you go out on a date, you don't want the first thing that the other person knows about you is that you need antipsychotic medicine, because, you know, that's not a good start. We all have a mask that we put up 24/7. And this is normal, it's healthy, because we kind of need that. Yeah? I mean, if you look at somebody's Facebook page, I think it's kind of public knowledge that that's not a very accurate representation of their life. They like it that way. Yeah? You want to show that you went out to a party, not what you looked like the next morning. And that's fine, that's normal, that's healthy. Problem is, of course, that without privacy, there is at least someone or some group of people or some system that knows the part you want to hide. That's not healthy, that's not good for people. Yeah. We need privacy, just as human beings. So, if we don't have this, the problem is, of course, also the argument that's being used by governments all the time is like, look, you know, we need these laws against terrorists, against criminals, etc. Reality is usually that they are the ones who are safe anyway, because they take care of their own privacy. After all, they have something to hide. Yeah, it's the people who have nothing to hide who actually need privacy, because they don't try to hide it. Yeah, grassroots political organizations or just normal human beings. That's a privacy argument. And, of course, we need to make changes in our society. Now, here at the conference, there are loads and loads and loads of people who are working on all kinds of levels to change this. I mean, there's political change needed. There's awareness needed, because vast majority of people doesn't know or just keep saying, I have nothing to hide, and doesn't realize that that's a problem. But, well, I'm from a technical group of people, so a thing that I work on, that we work on, is of course a technical side of it. We try to solve problems with technology, and to some degree that works. And the internet was actually a perfect solution for this. It was designed to be decentralized, to have nobody being in control of it, to be federated. And, you know, we screwed it up, because basically 80% of the internet these days is like five big American companies. That's not cool. I mean, for most of us, again, this is not a problem. We might not have all our data on Facebook or at Google, but the vast majority of people, for them, Facebook is the internet, or most of it. Or they don't like Facebook, so instead they use WhatsApp. Well, we all know what that means. They're still at Facebook. So we need to decentralize stuff. We need to have a solution that gives you the good of the cloud, but mitigates at least some of the bad, or as much as possible. Yeah, and decentralization can help us. And by the way, I want to also address the backdoor thing. I think, again, I'm preaching to the choir here, but we don't want a backdoor in security, in encryption, or in whatever solution we build. I mean, lately you see that, for example, WhatsApp is being used to distribute child porn. And I hate that. And I find it also quite fascinating, the news about it, because what did you expect? I mean, WhatsApp is end-to-end encrypted, which is really awesome. At the same time, it's great. I mean, why does anyone here have a hint as to why Facebook did end-to-end encryption on WhatsApp? How many people work at Facebook? Tens of thousands. How many people work at WhatsApp? A couple of hundred. Why? Well, they don't have to monitor what's happening, because they can't. That's why Facebook obviously is very happy with the end-to-end encryption in WhatsApp. They don't have to monitor the conversations that happen on WhatsApp. They don't have to monitor them for political issues, and I mean, then you get what happened to the Rohingya. Now, the problem, of course, with decentralized technology is that, and we need to realize that. And politicians, of course, they always want to have their cake too. They want to have backdoors in these technologies. And this is a complicated discussion to have. I full well realize that. But yeah, you can't decrease the security for everyone. That this stuff comes with downsides, and we need to be honest about that. I think the WhatsApp one is pretty serious, and what happened again with the Rohingya, I think many of you are probably aware, it's really nasty. Honestly, I don't really have an answer to this either, so I'm just making it worse perhaps by bringing that up, but either way, backdoors are not a good solution. That's the point I'm trying to make. We need to use other ways of law enforcement. As an example of what happened in Berlin a couple of years ago, was a guy, or, well, someone, I think it was a guy, burning up cars. And the Berlin police decided to try to use a telephone tap to find who it was. They tapped 4.2 million phones. If you know how many people live in Berlin, you know that's pretty much everyone. Yeah, the total number of telephone taps in Berlin area in 1994 was 919. So the police is also extremely escalating this stuff, right? Why did they in 1994, in a whole year, tap 900 phones? That was apparently enough for whatever law enforcement they did. And a couple of years ago, they needed 4.2 million. It's, yeah, well, there's a mess. Let's talk about getting your stuff back. I mean, I think all of you are convinced the cloud is good and the cloud is bad. We need to do something for that. And this is, of course, what Nextcloud was designed to do. Now, the idea behind Nextcloud is that it is a self-hosted technology that provides the services that the big boys are offering. Not all of it yet. I mean, my Nextcloud app doesn't warn me that when I'm going to San Francisco or something that I can get my maps. But this stuff is technically possible. And a lot of it can be done, and a lot of it we already do. Right now, our focus is to build a platform. And the basics is file sync and share. If you run a Nextcloud server, you can exchange your files between your devices. You can share it with other people. You can edit the files collaboratively in the web interface, and so on and on. We have cross-cloud sharing. So if you run a Nextcloud server and you run a Nextcloud server, you can share files with each other by just entering the username at the Nextcloud server. It's basically an email address. We call it a federated cloud ID. We have audio-video chat, that's not yet federated, but that's definitely one of the next steps we're working on. And because it only works if it's easy, we try to make Nextcloud as easy to use as possible, both for system administrators. It just requires a LAMP stack, which is the most basic Linux-based server setup there is. Still doesn't mean it's really easy. It's hard to run a server, sadly, but at least it's relatively easy. And it's the same for developers. We try to make it easy to work on it. So I have an app template. If you go to our app store and you want to be an app developer, it basically lets you generate an app that you then download, and you put it in your apps folder in Nextcloud, and it'll work. And obviously, it's just a skeleton app, but then you can get started and add your own code. Try to make it super easy. It's for Android, iOS, Linux, Windows, Mac. We have sync clients that you can have your files available on all of those. and of course a web interface. I'll skip through this. It just does all the stuff Office 365 and Friends are doing. That's what it boils down to. And there are about 200 Nextcloud apps, which of course gets us to the subject of my talk. I'll quickly go through a couple of other things that we do. Security is of course super important, and people often ask me, how do you keep data safe? Now obviously, perfection is really hard to achieve in this area, but we have a bug bounty program. So if you find a way to do the worst of the worst, which is a remote code execution vulnerability, you get 5K from us. And well, anything less bad than that, you get less money, obviously. But please, if you're a hacker, if you want to, you know, analyze the security of an app, go analyze security of Nextcloud and help hundreds of thousands of servers and tens of millions of people, because that's how many users we have. Yeah, we are by far the biggest self-hosted file sync and share solution, including bigger than all the proprietary competition. So that's pretty cool. We estimate about 300,000 Nextcloud servers, but guess what? We're not really tracking them, so it's kind of hard to know for sure. All right, it's yours, right? Nextcloud is completely open source, no proprietary components, nothing. And as I said, tens of millions of users, but also a lot of contributors. Get involved if you want. This is some pictures of us. We do a conference every year in Berlin, and every other month, we have a meeting, like a hack week, coding week in Stuttgart. Both of them are open. Everything is open, basically. The only thing that we close is like there's a company behind Nextcloud, which kind of provides services and support around the product to big companies. And well, everyone is of course there at those bi-monthly meetings, but products, roadmaps, all these things are all open. A lot of providers, a lot of companies host Nextcloud. Hetzner in Germany is new, not on the list yet, but there are hundreds of providers that host the Nextcloud, and where you can go and say, okay, you know, I can't run my own server, but you know, there's a company maybe in your city or in your country or just in Switzerland that you might trust with your data, and then you can put your files and your other data there. And this already provides a degree of decentralization, right? I know you're still giving your data to someone else, but you're no longer locked into like five big companies. You can choose between hundreds, and if you really don't like all of them, then get together with some friends and, you know, run a server together. It's not impossible, it's quite doable. A lot of people do it. The company has over 200 customers and dozens of partners. That's going quite well. If you're a big company, you need support or other services around Nextcloud, talk to us. That's part of the team. Old picture though. And again, I want to stress, we're just doing one part of the huge, you know, problem solving around privacy, right? These are a bunch of other projects. Some of them we work with, some of them we don't. But there are lots of other projects and communities that do privacy-related things. Now, that was more than enough, I think, about the big picture of Nextcloud. Let's go to those 200 things. So, Nextcloud does a whole bunch of things, but on our App Store, you can extend it with new features, new capabilities. There is some basic stuff, like for authentication, you can authenticate just with username, password. You can hook it up in an LDAP if you have that. And you can enable two-factor authentication. And then there are apps that you can install to extend the two-factor authentication. So it can be just the basic that you have TOTP, like Google Authenticator, YubiKey, U2F, other things. A nice feature in Nextcloud 15 is that you can actually just get a notification on an existing device. So you want to log into your phone, and then in your desktop app, you get a notification, hey, there's a login from this IP address, do you approve or deny? That's something we have that makes it a lot easier, I think, to use second-factor authentication. A lot of storage stuff on our App Store. You can store your files in Nextcloud itself, on the server you run Nextcloud on, but you don't have to. You can have an NFS, an FTP drive somewhere, but even a Google Drive, you can store your files in Google Drive and then access them from your Nextcloud. Which is quite nice because Nextcloud also has server-side encryption. So that encrypts the files before they're stored, which means you're using Google Drive, but Google doesn't have access to your data, as you encrypt it before it's sent over there. pretty neat. Have your cake and eat it too. I use Google, but I don't give them my data. There is Sia and Storage, which both do blockchain storage. So everyone who was doing a bingo card on blockchain, here you go. And there's a lot more security related stuff. One thing that's really cool that I want to talk about for a minute is a project by the University of Konstanz. They were trying to figure out what would be the best way to counter ransomware. So you have a ransomware attack, what kind of infrastructure would you need in place to counter it? And they detected it and they did whatever it is. Kind of an analysis of like, you know, what are the properties that make the perfect ransomware? Okay, then how do you counter something with those properties? And they actually came up with the idea that actually what you need is a way to detect files that were suddenly encrypted and then roll back these changes. And well, they use Nextcloud at the University of Konstanz, and the professor is also a private Nextcloud user. So they thought, you know, Nextcloud has a versioning system, can bring back files. Maybe we can use that. So they developed an app that whenever you upload a file, it does an entropy analysis. And that tells them whether a file is encrypted or not. So if suddenly you start to upload lots of encrypted files, which means there's ransomware encrypting all your files, they basically set a flag on those files and say, okay, suddenly on this date and time, there's a whole bunch of files being uploaded that are encrypted by maybe encrypted and maybe ransomware. And then later you can go into the app and say, hey, yes, that was ransomware. Please restore all my files. And all your files are back the way they were just before they were encrypted by the ransomware. It's pretty cool and really nice. That's an app in the App Store. We had already developed another app which monitors all the uploads and looks for specific, you know, patterns in file names, because most of the ransomware puts a certain README or renames the files in a certain way. And this will block actually all your uploads if it detects one of these patterns. You can manually add and remove patterns, so hey, maybe you can come up for other use case for this. But it does help even to kind of preempt ransomware. And it will also ping the administrator, so universities use this, because if then one of their students gets infected, they get warned and they can, you know, take action, tell other students to be careful, and so on. So there's a lot of other security stuff in Nextcloud. There's an app that can block access based on IP address, can manage brute force protection settings. So we have a brute force protection that if you try a password, you type the wrong password, it lets you wait 1 second to type again, then 2 seconds, 3, 5, 10. So you can't just brute force your way through finding a password of someone. And there's even an antivirus app, which basically just pipes all the files through an antivirus app. You could even build another, you know, or use another virus scanner. Like, I think the default is ClamAV, which is not the very best. But it's possible to use another virus scanner, and then it checks all your files for viruses. There's a bunch of applications around security. We have 2 password managers and an app that can authenticate users through Discourse. No, wait, the other way around. Can use Nextcloud to authenticate to Discourse forums that have it installed. And there's a KeyWeb app which can open your KeyPass files. So if you use KeyPass, then actually you can also access them from Nextcloud. There's this like GDPR, DSGVO, etc. thing. We have a bunch of apps that basically help you deal with that. So they allow you to have a terms of service. They let you put all these things in that you need to be GDPR compatible. Really cool little app that I know I'm now going randomly through our apps, by the way, just to be clear. I thought this is a really cool app. Although I did categorize it, this just isn't in the category where it's supposed to be. But so files from mail, basically you set up a mailbox on your mail server, and this app looks in the mailbox, and when somebody sends a file there, it stores the attachment on Nextcloud in a folder named after the sender. So you can basically use this to monitor a mailbox and have all the files then available on your file sync and share. Pretty little thing. And there are like dozens of other tools for Nextcloud, like right-click menu, change the menu order, tracking of Momoto. Yeah, I made a list here because showing you all these apps is kind of a little much. I personally use a share renamer. So with Nextcloud, if you make a shared link, you get like this random string, which is very nice and secure and otherwise impossible to remember. For a private home user, it's kind of nice to be able to just give that link a name. Then you can remember it and give it to other people over the phone rather than, you know, only by email or chat. Of course, if you really are worried about security, you shouldn't give logical names to your shared links because it makes it a lot easier to guess them. So, you know, stay awake with this kind of stuff. A really cool app, I think, is the Snapshots app. So Nextcloud has versions, as I mentioned earlier, right? It keeps older versions of all your files. And it can actually do that integrated with file systems that keep versions of files. So rather than making its own copies of older versions of files, which is what Nextcloud normally does, it will rely on the file system like ZFS or ButterFS to make copies of the files and then shows you in the web interface the older versions of these files and lets you roll back changes, etc. Really neat. I recently did a fantastic blog about this. I thought it was funny. So there's an app that lets you insert random JavaScript on any page on Nextcloud, which means around this time of the year, you can have snow in your Nextcloud. Yeah, of course, you can also use it to enter any kind of tracking JavaScript, which you might want to do for yourself, obviously. You're running your own server, right? Or anything else. I mean, JavaScript can do quite a lot. So those are a bunch of smaller apps and tools. Of course, there are a lot of really big apps for Nextcloud that really do a lot. And a big part is what we're building here, right? We want to build an alternative to Office 365. And Office 365 and Google Apps, they do more than just sync files. They let you edit files together. They let you have audio and video calls and chat. You can comment on files. And all this stuff is available for Nextcloud. So you can edit a document on your mobile phone together with other people. You can have a video call with people while you're editing a document. These features we can do with apps, of course. For the document editing, you can use either Collabora Online or only Office. They're both open source and installable. I wouldn't say entirely easy, but it's doable. There's some documentation, etc. So. And why would you not use separate apps for these things? Well, because these are integrated. So for example, here on the left, I'm sharing a file and it's sharing it to a conversation. So you can share a file directly to a chat room in Nextcloud Talk. And then, you know, here's the chat and you see the file appears then in the chat there. That's what you get with the integration. It's quite clever because that chat had a public share link, so there were users in there who didn't have a Nextcloud account. Now, if you have a Nextcloud account and you would click the image that I showed here, if you click the image there as Nextcloud user and you're logged in, you go on the left, you go to your files, and you see there the file that, you know, is now shared with you because you're in the chat, you have access to the file, therefore it's in your list of files. And you click it, you just go to the listing. But if you're an external user and you don't have a Nextcloud account on this server and you click the link, then you see on the right, you see a public share link automatically. So it distinguishes like, oh, you're logged in, here's the file. You're not logged in, here's a public share link to the file. And as user, you don't need to do anything for this, it just works. I thought that was kind of clever when I discovered that the first time. There's lots of other apps that do stuff for productivity. Yeah, calendars, contacts, and mails. We have a really cool Kanban app, Deck. You can share files into a anyone familiar with Kanban? It's like you have these buckets of tasks, you put cards in them, move them between buckets, like to do, done, in progress, usually in a different order. It's quite nice. There's a whole bunch of note-taking apps, and they often come with like mobile apps. So there's like two Android apps for note-taking, I think. One of them uses simple markdown files. The other one stores the stuff in the database, but it does a lot of fancy tagging and other stuff. It depends what you're looking for. I personally like just flat markdown files, which is really easy to take notes with. There's a downloader app, music, radio app, weather app, a GitHub merge tracker. You give it a GitHub repo and it tells you, and you give it another GitHub repo. You want to merge things between them, and then it shows you all the issues in one, or all the pull requests in one. And then you mark them done when you've merged them, for example. Sync SMSs from your phone. I did a double sync there, but you know, that's what phone sync does, syncs your SMSs. There's even FB sync, so it gets most of your data from Facebook and imports it into Nextcloud. So you can even move over. Bookmarks, ebook reading, OPDS, I had to look it up. It's a syndication format for electronic publications based on Atom and HTTP, which makes it possible to access those publications, not limited to electronic books, on any client device. Examples are tablets, e-readers, etc. I haven't used 90% of the apps in our app store, but, you know, I can read. The XMPP. If you still use XMPP, I think it's one of these kind of sad protocols, no offense, but like it kind of failed to pick up, even though it was a really good idea. So I can have a long conversation about that, but there's an app for Nextcloud, so if you want to use it, you can. Some highlights. I'm gonna try to do less lists and more, you know, like big stuff about the apps. So there's phone track. Yes, you can track your phone also with Nextcloud. It makes like nice graphs of where you've been and all that stuff. I think it's cool. I haven't actually used it, but it's quite a nice idea. I mean, if you got kids, maybe, you know. Talking about tracking, so there's three GPX apps that can display, analyze, and compare GPX tracks, also edit them and animate them in your Nextcloud. Quite nice. There's draw.io integration, so you can, you know, make nice drawings in Nextcloud. Pretty neat. This is really brilliant. Our designer came up with this. It's called Keep and Sweep. If you want to clean up your data, it shows you a random file and then a button that says keep or delete. Very nice. I thought it was very creative. He actually made hardware buttons for it. So like two USB hardware buttons and then you beep, beep. Yeah, it's nice. I think he's working also on the Windows and Linux and the Mac version of the file that just takes all the files on your drive and just randomly shows them and then, you know, keep or sweep. DCOM viewers. So DCOM files are the kind of files that radiologists use to, you know, like look at. And there's an app for Nextcloud that actually can display them and is being used by some radiologists to, you know, well, keep the data in a place where they control it rather than the vendor of their X-ray machine or, you know, wherever the stuff is being kept. I mentioned LDAP integration. There's also normally the Nextcloud LDAP integration is read-only, so it just functions as a, yeah, one-way thing, so you can't break anything. But if you like breaking stuff, there is actually an app that does read-write LDAP, and you can actually manage LDAP from within Nextcloud with that. I mentioned Markdown. I really like it, and there's an app for it. This is not the most flattering screenshot because it can actually embed also pictures and videos and all kinds of stuff. And the really nice thing that I also didn't screenshot is that if you share a public link to a Markdown file, it renders it then. So the recipient gets actually the rendered Markdown file and the download button below it, which is really nice, and I use it now to distribute our press releases. I just make like whole, you know, documents for the press, like, hey, new release, all the features, here are screenshots, text, bullet lists, etc. And, you know, they can download it or just look at it from the web. Very nice. Even nicer on top of that is that there is a tool, Pico CMS, or that's what it's based on, that basically takes a tree of Markdown files and renders it to HTML as a website and then makes that accessible. It has some really clever, so basically you have a website like a blog or a documentation or something that you maintain by just editing Markdown files, which you can do right with the nice preview here. And it's then published on a URL on yourcloud.com/website name. Yeah, you can have multiple websites, you can give them all a theme. And your sharing settings, you can actually make them public or only visible to people who are on your Nextcloud or even only people who are in a certain group on your Nextcloud. So you can just use this to manage documentation of a team of people, for example. And if you then share the folder with them, then they can also edit the documentation together, and you can just maintain your docs that way as a charity, for example. Quite nice. It's super simple. It requires very little knowledge. Markdown is simple, and it requires like the only installation step you need is like one click, and then it's all running and you can build websites. It's really nice. We have two mind map apps. One of them is taking a minimalist approach of starting from scratch. The other one has embedded something big and complicated. Pick your poison. Released just a few weeks ago is Nextcloud Social. We're joining the Fediverse. If you're not aware, there is a federated network of Twitter-like technologies out there. Multiple servers, Mastodon might ring a bell. It's actually part of the Fediverse. There are a bunch of other solutions for it too. And Nextcloud is now basically a Fediverse compatible server. So you can have your Facebook-like feed. You can subscribe to the feeds of other people, cross servers, the whole thing. It's still an alpha. It's being tested and improved. There's a lot of work to do. But at the same time, of course, it's really cool. And well, another step in the direction of replacing the big players. And of course, integrate the Nextcloud. So, you know, share a document and public links and all that stuff. We're very happy with that. Now, for the people who are already using Nextcloud, I have a few things that you didn't know. You might have heard of the External Sites app. You can basically take any website and have it on the blue bar there on top as an app. Yeah, and it then shows up with the nice blue familiar bar on top. But it's still, of course, an external app. But it doesn't have to be on the top there. You can have it as a little link in the top left, under, bottom left, therefore, or in the top settings menu there. It's nice, and you can configure it. There's also a language setting, so you can say, okay, you know, I have people who speak Spanish, German, and French. So you have pages external for each of them separate, and then whatever the language is of their browser, they will see a different app show up instead of having to have French, German, and Spanish standing there all the time in the top bar. Quite nice. Play with it. Circles. I mostly put it here because a lot of people are confused about what it does. So we have a bit of a messy situation to some degree in Nextcloud. You have groups that you manage as an administrator, and then people can share to these groups and be in the groups. You have the address book, which of course also has its own groups. And you can now with Circles app make groups yourself as user and then share with them or have other people join these groups. And we are looking at how to integrate those three types of groups together, and that will come in a future release. But until now, you can at least use all of this. It's quite nice. This is kind of cool. So we have a workflow engine in Nextcloud that basically allows you to define some rules. And then when a file gets uploaded that matches those rules, stuff like file size, file type, IP range, user of group of the uploader, or client type, then a certain tag is set. Now, what are you gonna do with the tags? Well, a whole bunch of things. First of all, you can, for example, set the file retention on these files. So files that are uploaded by our Outlook client get automatically deleted after 10 days. That's a rule you can set, and then Nextcloud takes care of that and cleans them up. You can say, okay, files that are uploaded, that are docx files and uploaded between 9 and 10 by people in the group Bananas, get automatically converted to PDF. Done. Or run through script, or you know, you name it. Or, of course, you block access completely. You say, okay, you know, files that are from the HR department cannot be shared outside of a certain IP range, period. That kind of stuff's possible as well. I have a beautiful empty slide. Just to point out that, really, I did 70 slides already, and you know, there are a lot more apps. I just couldn't get to it, so we're almost out of time. Are there any questions? Oh, thank you. I know it's a lot that you can do with Nextcloud, but I still want to invite everyone to help us build more apps and do more things with Nextcloud, because we still have a lot of services to replace. The moment my phone warns me when I go on holiday that, you know, it can download the map from me, but it's all self-hosted. I look forward to that. Please help make it happen. You had a question? Shoot.
I have a question regarding encryption.
Encryption, yeah, okay.
You talked about encrypting the files.
Yes.
On the server. And I wonder if the encryption is server-sided, or are the files encrypted on the client and then uploaded in as encrypted files, because that would be great.
Yes, but that also means you won't have a web interface anymore. You can't edit them in the web interface, you can't see them in the web interface, you can't have previews, you can't share them anymore. So yes, actually on both. We have a server-side encryption, which you can use either to only encrypt files that go to storage, so that protects you against an evil storage, say Google Drive. You can also have them encrypted all the time on the server itself, with a key that is then in turn encrypted by the user's password, which in practice means when the user isn't logged in, no one has access to those files. The downside of it is share with a group, admin add somebody to the group. If the user doesn't log in, the new member of the group doesn't have access to the files. It's bad for performance, but it's as an option do. And then the third option that you have is end-to-end encryption. We offer it in our clients. But, you know, that means that on the folder, because you pick one folder or multiple folders that are end-to-end encrypted, we have to keep in mind that any folder that is end-to-end encrypted, the server does not have access to those files. So you can't send them as a public link to someone, you can't edit them, you can't see them, etc. But for a subset of your files, it makes sense and it's an option. Yes.
Okay, thanks.
Any more questions? Yes.
You have hardware recommendations for single user? Is a Pi 3 enough?
Yeah, so Pi is really, really minimal. Basically, any board that's a bit stronger than that will do. I mean, the Pi works, but you'll be annoyed sometimes. Another thing you need to keep in mind, there's a lot of caching that you can do to speed up Nextcloud. In the end, it's the downside of, well, the upside of a PHP app is it's easy to install all these apps, because all of them you install with one click, really. Just there's a list of app, click enable, and then they get downloaded and turned on, and they're there. That's nice. The downside is PHP is a bit heavy, and every time it does something, for example, upload a file, it needs to start up the whole universe of PHP and then kill it again at the end, which means if you are uploading one gigabyte file, the overhead is negligible, and your limitation is going to be your data cable speed. If you're uploading 1,000 1-kilobyte files, expect to wait a very long time, especially if you have a slow server. So, yeah, we're working on at some point packing multiple files in one upload and decreasing the overhead, but at the moment that's still an issue. It won't hurt too much in practice when you're syncing just the first time. Yeah.
What about a full text indexing of documents like PDF files?
Yeah, so there's an OCR app that can OCR and then extract the text from images and PDFs. And there's a full text indexer as well, actually two, choice. One is Elasticsearch based, and the other one is based on Apache Solr, I think. Again, pick your poison.
So you mentioned this document wiki thing with Markdown.
Yeah, Pico CMS.
Yeah, and do you know Confluence?
Confluence. I've heard of it, but that's about it. Can't say anything smart about it.
Okay,
sorry.
but yeah, I think it's comparable then. Yeah.
Oh, I'm not saying there aren't other solutions. It's just when you're already running Nextcloud to be able to install this with one click and have it work. And Pico CMS is an external project, right? We didn't build the whole thing ourselves. We just took it, embedded it into Nextcloud, made it easy to use there. That was this. Yes?
I'm facing problems when I try to exclude files from the files link.
With the client, configuration.
Yeah, yeah. So I try to exclude files that are provided on the client. For example, class files that I compiled with a...
It should work, but come by us. Like, this is not a great support forum.
Yeah, perfect.
There's a bunch of questions there. Could we get the microphone there? All right, cool. Yeah.
Yeah. Is there a security concept for the plugins, for example, to make sure that they do not connect to any other server?
So while we do a fair bit to make sure that it's hard for app authors to write insecure codes, we don't do anything to prevent them from being evil. So no. It's also very hard to do in PHP, I understand. So so what we do have is, as an app author, you have to sign your apps. And we have in our app store, obviously, I mean, we can't review all apps, so we don't. I have to be honest about that. I mean, we would love to. It's just we would need to hire 3 people just to do that. And, well, we can't. We do obviously would kick out anything that's insecure and ban the author for life, etc. And we have a categorization of like official and unofficial and testing apps, I believe. We need to refine that a little bit when we grow, because we're growing pretty quick. Last year, if I would have given this talk, I would have said there are 100 apps. So it's going pretty fast. And we will need to expand on that in the future. But right now, it's mainly a matter of trust. You know, like you get to be an official app if we've seen you face to face at a conference and didn't think you were evil.
I wasn't thinking about code review per se, but maybe rules.
Yeah.
This app cannot connect to any other server. But I get your point.
Yeah. So those kind of access rights are, my understanding is that it's really hard to do. It might be possible, but it's currently not in place in any case, whether it's doable or not. Any more questions?
I've got a developer question. Do you have any infrastructure for web services to provide them to get easy web services for your plugins? So, for example, if I have an app and I would like to back up my data in the Nextcloud database via REST API, is there already an infrastructure for that?
Yeah, some of it. So, first of all, Nextcloud just uses web dev. And REST API for everything. Depending on how complicated it is, what you want to do, I mean, you can just put a file on Nextcloud using the Web Dev API, that's easy enough. If you want to put stuff in the database, you would have to write a simple server-side, Nextcloud-side app that takes the data from your app. But it's nothing too complicated. There are apps that do that. I mean, essentially, that's what the Notes app does, plus giving you a web interface. But, yeah. So we're sitting over there. There's a Nextcloud flag hanging there, one of the boats. Come by, ask questions if you have them, or ask me now, because I think we should end this. So thanks for listening. Have a nice day, everyone.